Anger, Part 33.
Jai Sachidanand.
I bow down to the Absolute Pure Soul within all of you, with utmost devotion and oneness. My salutations, my salutations, my salutations.
Jai Sachidanand.
In the topic on anger, there were a few talks about the type of anger that breaks the heart of the other person to such an extent that then it cannot be mended for the entire life. There's some details on it in the book Pratikarman. We shall read it.
Heading: The most intense type of kashaya. Now, what have the scripture writers written? Suppose a man says just two sentences that break this woman's heart. That man speaks in such a way that it breaks her heart, such that it will not mend in her entire life. Her mind becomes permanently fractured. What have the scripture writers called this? Anantanubandhi krodh. This anger is such that it will make one wander for infinite lives.
The heart gets broken in such a manner that the other person has no desire to come together at all. The relations with that person get cut off. However, the relations do not remain cut off forever. In the next life, from extreme abhorrence, there will be extreme attachment. From attachment, when the expectations don't get fulfilled, then again, there's abhorrence. Therefore, the turmoil of attachment and abhorrence. The root cause of all of this is the ignorance of the self. It's the fundamental mityatva moha, the illusory attachment that makes one see only worldly life as correct. He does not know, who am I? Why does anger arise? Why were you joking around with my wife? Because he has extreme moha on his wife. He feels extreme abhorrence towards the other person. Then such harsh words are spoken that it breaks the heart of the other person. Or if he has extreme attachment with money, and if the other person does not return the 5,000 rupees which are lent to him, then he'll say, now I won't spare him. Such kind of tremendous... If he has given his house for someone to use, and if the other person spoils the house, then he'll start quarreling in a way that it breaks the other person's heart. It's such a strong kashaya. Therefore, these kinds of faults, he has moha on worldly things, and on the basis of that, he ends up getting angry. Further, at a subtle level, he has moha for his pride. I am something. If his pride is wounded, even then, he'll get very angry. It's such an intense moha, and on the basis of that, there's the existence of Anantanubandhi kashaya, which is the most intense type of kashayas, which leads to infinite bondage in births and obstructs self-realization. When one has tremendous moha for enjoying sex, he goes to extreme levels of deceit, extreme levels of greed. He goes to the extent of Anantanubandhi. And if something goes wrong, then the abhorrence goes up to the extent of having the desire to kill that person. Why is that? This is because there's extreme moha. He gets extremely suspicious. He quarrels. He believes that all this is everything to me. When one has moha of worldly things, terrible anger, pride, deceit, greed arise. They are referred to as Anantanubandhi kashayas. Read on.
If another kind of anger has arisen, then she will not speak with him for a year or so. Her wounds will heal after a year. She will forget the anger and it will heal. So what kind of anger lasts for a year? Apratyakhyani krodh, meaning anger for which one did not have any remorse, for which pratikraman had not been done. That is why it came forth.
His moha for the worldly life has decreased a bit. When he starts attending spiritual discourses with the saints, or if he begins following some religion, or if he gets some beatings, and he realizes, oh, what I did was wrong, only then will he turn around. Or else if he does not feel what he has done is wrong, then Anantanubandhi will not decrease. However, if by chance his merit karma has come into fruition, and he follows some religion, he repents, he turns back, there's no remorse as such, But instead of going in that direction, he turns towards religion or satsang, so it decreases a bit. Now, what is that anger like? The person ends up quarreling, the suffering remains for 1 or 2 years, and the relationship gets cut off. Then slowly with time, the two unite. So here it says, apratyakhyani krodh, meaning anger for which one did not have any remorse, for which pratikarma was never done. These are the kind of faults. So these are the forms of anger. Just like anger, there's pride, there's greed, deceit, and moha. The scripture writers have written about all of these forms of faults. The Tirthankar lords have given all of these talks.
Questioner, is the anger that is expressing now the same anger that had occurred in the past? Nadashri, no, it is not like that. If pratikraman is not done after anger occurs, then the anger will come out with the same force again. If one does not do pratikraman after expressing anger, then it will last for a year. And if he does pratikraman, then it will last for 15 days. After 15 days, they will resume speaking to one another. They will forget about everything. That is what has been called pratyakhyani krodh by the Lord.
So who is he referring to? What is the Lord trying to say? Lord says that the anger is of this kind. Here, Dada's speech is in a conversational tone. Many people have had such experiences here. For periods of 20 years, brothers were not speaking with each other. When they attained Gnan and did tremendous pratikraman, then one of the brothers took the first step and spoke with the other one in person. Their worldly interactions became normal again. Why is that? This is because their grudge dissolved. Many people have had such experiences. Dada says, anger for which one did not have any remorse or did not do pratikraman is referred to as apratyakhyani krodh. In this type of anger, he feels, what I'm doing is wrong. I'm making some mistake. He feels a little bit of this, but then again, the veils come over it. In this way, after a lot of time, it decreases. The force of this anger is such that he invariably ends up getting angry. But pratyakhyani anger means he starts doing a lot of pratikraman. Oh, whatever is happening is wrong. It should not be like this. When a lot of pratikraman and pratyakhyan happen, then the divisiveness that had arisen between the two gets mended within 15 days. That is referred to as pratyakhyani anger. But he does a lot of pratikraman for that. He continuously does pratikraman. He has a lot of remorse over his own faults. However, if he is in a state of ignorance of the self that I am Chandubhai and I made a mistake, then he binds merit karma. But the karma does not get destroyed. For attaining moksha, the pratikraman and pratyakhyan that happens after he realizes, I am pure soul. With that, new seeds are not sown and the old ones get burnt and emptied. They get destroyed. That's useful for attaining moksha.
Anantanubandhi krodh is anger that will fracture a person internally for his or her entire life. It is like a big crack of a foot or two wide that forms between rock cliffs. No matter how much gets filled in it, the original crack will remain forever.
The scripture writers have described this as, say there's a rock cliff and a big crack forms on it. However much one tries to fill it, it just won't get joined. It's that kind of anger, a very terrible type of anger. The second kind of anger, if he feels repentance within, or if he feels that this is wrong, if he understands that, or if he finds good company and he observes, oh, even though it was a big fight, this person didn't do anything. What I'm doing is so wrong. If he realizes it a bit, then he turns back. And when he turns back, now the other type of anger.
In comparison, the one that lasts for a year or so is apratyakhyani. It is comparable to the cracks that form in the ground of the farmland. They will eventually fill up after a year.
So what is this like? When mud dries out, it seems that there's cracks within. if there's intense heat, 6-inch wide cracks get formed in the farmland. A 1-foot deep ditch gets formed. However, when there's heavy rainfall, then gradually the crack seals. We can see it get sealed. Whereas in the case of the crack in the rock cliff, we cannot see it getting joined back. It's not even possible. Whereas here, it happens. That kind of anger is referred to as apratyakhani krodh. When there's a lot of rainfall, within 15 days or a month, the crack gets sealed with the rains. Read on.
Then, there is the anger that lasts for 15 days or so. That is pratyakhani. It is like a marking formed in the sand. If you were to draw a line in the sand on a beach, then what would end up happening? How long would it be before it is erased? Questioner: immediately, as soon as the wind comes. Dadashri: it gets smudged when the wind comes. It may take 1 hour or even 2 hours. That is called pratyakhani krodh.
If we were to draw a line in the sand by the beach, and if there's no wind, then the line will remain as it is for 4 hours. However, when the breeze blows, either at night or in the daytime, during a high tide or low tide, when the wind blows, then the line gets erased. At the most, it'll last for 24 hours. The marking in the sand gets erased in a few hours. Such is the type of this anger. What is it like? If there's some quarrel between the two, it'll get resolved within 15 days. The divisiveness gets wiped out. The hurt that the two may have caused to each other is ignored. They patch up. That is referred to as apratyakhani krodh. He has genuine repentance within. I ended up hurting him. Through only that repentance and pratikarman, that fault gets erased. In the previous case, he feels a bit, what I did was wrong. That happens once or twice out of 100 times, and then the veils come over it. The purpose behind studying all this is basically we have become separate from file number one, but the filled stock of karma still remains. Which karmic tuber is big? To what extent? There are sticky faults. Apratyakhani means sticky faults. Pratyakhani and Sanjwalan, or the mild kashai that are easily reversible, are the less sticky ones. Based on this understanding, we are able to figure out later as to what extent our faults have decreased.
And the fourth is like a line that is drawn in water and gets erased immediately. That is considered like a line drawn in water. That is Sanjwalan Krodh. Not all Mahatmas have anger like a line drawn in water. For most, it will mend after 15 days or so. For some, it may even be like a line drawn in water.
If we were to draw a line in water, as we move forward, the starting point of the line is already beginning to get erased. So it's almost negligible. Within 6 to 12 hours, usually what happens with us is that when we end up getting angry, we feel a lot of repentance within. That too is with certain sticky files, like between file 1 and file 2, or file 3 and 4. The karmas are sticky, so it seems like a line drawn on sand. Things get patched up within 2 to 5 days. Whereas with distant files, it's very negligible. It arises within. We do pratikarman for that, and then the case is sorted. It's like this in a lot of matters for our Mahatmas. In the case of faults, which act as spiritual roadblocks, it's like apratyakhani. Where the intensity is reduced, it's like pratyakhani. In some matters, like if one incurs a loss, he won't feel bothered. If one has a tuber of pride, then he's not affected in matters of greed. He has no problem if something is damaged. Nothing happens at all. In so many matters, we have become free from the effect. We have progressed to a higher stage. However, in case of spiritual roadblocks, sticky faults, fireworks continue even after 15 years. So we feel that it's still in the process of dissolving. It's considered as pratyakhani. Why is that? This is because we are doing pratikarman. Whereas in some matters, we weren't doing pratikarman at all. There were thick veils. In my case, I had this vanik or merchant class prakriti. Niruma had cautioned me so many times, you're doing this and doing that. However, I was not able to realize it. In what way is it a vanik prakriti? In what way am I not talking in a straightforward manner? I'd feel, yes, there's some mistake, but then again, the veils of ignorance would come over me. In this way, many years passed by. Then I slowly started understanding. Even then, I haven't understood it completely. If someone cautions me, I realize, oh, I prevailed as a vanik again. So, there are intense veils. In case of our Mahatmas, new veils won't arise. The old ones will keep dissolving gradually, and everything will get emptied out.
Deepak Bhai, so the Anantano Bandhi, Pratyakhyani and Apratyakhyani faults, do they vary with each different fault?
Yes, they do. For the most part, as long as there's a deep delusion, the faults don't reduce. Haven't we seen the kashayas that happened amongst family members? How much did they fight? It's only now, in the last 15 to 20 years, that we received this gnan, and we came in touch with Dada's talks. I've seen such extreme kinds of fights where brothers wouldn't speak to each other for their entire life, or a person would not speak to his wife's brother. I've seen all this. The kashayas are so intense that people cut off relations. It seems like they follow religion to some extent. They may be following the Jain religion or the Vaishnava religion. They may be doing some devotional viewing of God. However, they have severe faults. But because we met Dada, and because this Gnanvidhi is so tremendously powerful that it bypasses all the kashayas and we receive the awareness of the pure soul. However, it does not end there. Back then, during those days, there were not many satsangs. So one would get to attend satsang after a gap of 5 to 12 months. He would think, what Dada Bhagwan is saying is right. People attended thinking this. And when they came, Dada was full of compassion, so he would properly spray medicine to cure their diseases. With this, the disease, the faults, would gradually dissolve, and he would feel, oh, what I'm doing is wrong. This happened to my father too. He took gnan in 1972. He used to attend satsang on and off for a year or so. Then one day he said, Dada, I'm having all these problems in my family. He had severed relations with everyone in the family. He had fought for the sake of money, for his pride. He used to blame them and everything. Then Dada asked, who's the sufferer? He said, clearly, I'm the one who's suffering. Dada said, then it's indeed your fault. So he realized, with Dada's grace, his veils broke and he said, my pratikraman went on for 72 hours. He came out of a lot of faults. He felt very light. Gradually, relations with extended family members became amicable. Earlier, he wouldn't want to meet them at all, or he wouldn't want to attend any social function. All that gradually decreased. These veils are such, but the changes happened through this gnan, with the grace of the gnani. Otherwise, these are the Anantanu Bandhi Kashai. They make one wander in the worldly life. Even those in connection with him have to wander.
After receiving this gnan, the Anantanu Bandhi break, correct?
They definitely break. Actually, the ones whose Anantanu Bandhi are broken or are about to break are the ones that receive this gnan. If one has tremendous merit karma, only then he attains this. For us, the Anantanu Bandhi and the other three, Mithyatvamo, Mishramo, and Samyakatvamo, all these three break. Our Akram Vignan is such that all seven types of Prakriti break.
These scripture writers have made a statement that the intellect accepts, isn't it? Questioner. It is a point that the self will accept. Dadashri, which Atma is it? The Vyavahar Atma? Worldly interacting self? The Pratishtit Atma? The relative self? That is a ploy of the intellect. And which kind of Atma is it? It is all the Vyavahar Atma. The original self, Mur Atma, knows even that. It knows everything.
Dada was such that in his speech, Dada continued to give exact revelations of the self. Here Dada says, this is something that the intellect accepts, isn't it? The person replies, yes, the Atma accepts it. To ensure that he has not incorrectly understood it, Dada clarifies, it's not the original self, it's the worldly interacting self, or the Vyavaratma, the one who believes, I am Chandu. That part is accepting it right now. And that too, when the intellect accepts it, only then the ego agrees, yes, this is acceptable. That is referred to as the worldly interacting self. We'll continue reading the next two pages. We'll get a detailed explanation on the forms of veils.
Heading: Apratyakhyan Avran Kashay. Questioner: once the Anantanubandhi Kashay, the most intense type of Kashay which leads to infinite bondage and births and obstructs self-realization, breaks, it begins descending. So then, does it keep decreasing gradually?
Basically, at the root level, there's moh. There's intense moh, which can even turn into very intense moh. He may be doing some rituals or following some religion, but he has a lot of greed in the business and a lot of attachment for the family. He will say, I won't be able to live without you. He'll say, one cannot live without money. Such attachments and abhorrence. He has intense attachment for worldly life. He has attachment and abhorrence. That is referred to as moh. All that is considered moh. Then gradually he finds some satsang or a religion to follow. He comes into such an atmosphere where he feels cool and calm within. True happiness indeed lies here. Moreover, if he gets to know something about the self is worth knowing. True happiness lies in the self. There's nothing but unhappiness in the worldly life. Nobody's going to become my own. The ones who I believe to be mine betrayed me. By listening to such religious discourses, he calms down a bit. His kashayas become dormant. At that time, this part of Anantanubandhi kashay break. It wears down a bit. The moh wears down a bit. And someday, when the guru or the saint says, the self is the only thing worth knowing, then he feels, oh, true bliss is only in the self. That is considered as having attained the right belief. As such, this is still. The word used is Vyavahara Samkit, the right belief in the relative sense. There's something like moksha. There's a path to attain moksha. The Tirthankars can take us to moksha. When he comes to such a realization, when such faith sets in, that is referred to as Vyavahara Samkit. He begins to feel for a bit, maybe for an hour or so, that true happiness lies in the self. And that is referred to as the right belief that remains for a very short time, Upsham Samkit. However, when he goes to work or gets involved at home or comes in worldly interactions, then the veils of ignorance come over him. Once Upsham Samkit goes away, then it may or may not come back in many lives. A lot of time passes. However, if a person has had the real right belief, it's Nishchay Samkit. If one has tasted the happiness even a little bit, that's referred to as Upsham Samkit. That is when those Anantanubandhi, anger, pride, deceit, greed are broken. Because he has tasted it. He likes it. It's worth practicing religion. The worldly life is wrong. It's a deception. This body is temporary. The self is permanent. He grasps few such words. And slowly, he turns in that direction. That's referred to as Mishramo. He likes satsang as well as the worldly life. Gradually, he progresses further and he begins to like satsang more. His dispassion for the worldly life keeps increasing. He reduces his moh towards worldly life. As he progresses in that, it so happens that it doesn't happen to tens of thousands of people, but only to one or two in the entire world. Samyakatva moh arises. What is the self? How must the self be? Day and night, he has no other desire but to know the self. When one reaches that stage, it is referred to as Samyakatva moh. The other four have decreased. The Pratyakhyani, Apratyakhyani, and Sanjwalan exist, but they are gradually decreasing. When one keeps coming to satsang, the Apratyakhyani wears out. So this way, he keeps turning back from intense moh. He can even fall back from having intense moh to having very intense moh. When is that more prevalent? When people get into differences of opinion over religion. Our religion is correct. If he insists on his opinions and differences, his mole becomes very intense. Dinantanubandhi kashais are unyielding at that point. Therefore, it becomes very difficult to get rid of those. Despite following a religion, the attachment for that religion, or the insistence for that religion, or moha for that religion, does not allow dinantanubandhi to decrease, and the moha intensifies a lot. Then he continues to get beatings for it. It keeps on dissolving. We have gone through all this in the worldly life, and now we've come into this group of dada. Now what remains is, it's mentioned on the previous page, as one keeps doing pratikraman, he keeps progressing further. Pratikraman and the right vision, or the vision as the self, these are the two biggest supports, based on which the faults can decrease and can be dissolved. Read on.
Is the circumstance of meeting Agnani necessary to break the Anantanubandhi kashais?
There's nothing better than that. In fact, that dissolves many more things. And even otherwise, if one meets some religious guru, saints, or religious heads, it makes a significant difference. The right understanding, before kashais, there is mithyatvamo, the illusory attachment that makes one see only worldly life as correct. Now that moha wears down. Oh, this is wrong. When the faith sets in that there is moksha, and it is worth going to moksha, this is wrong, this is greed, this is moha, the wife, the children, it's all deception. Don't they meditate on the 12 intentions as mentioned in the Jain scriptures? However, it should be done heartily. There should be a change of heart. Intellect means it learns everything through repetition, but it does not touch one's heart. When it touches the heart, the faults reduce. Those are some very beautiful intentions.
But does it break with all that?
That happens later on. Later means if a person has a guru who has attained the right belief of I am pure soul, then he can make the person realize that very speedily. And if the guru has not attained the right belief, but if the guru is heartily, like Ramana Maharshi, he was heartily. He did not have any fuss of the intellect. He didn't have any pomp and show. There was nothing ostentatious and rigid about him, as in the daily routine should be like this and like that, regular studies have to be done, etc. That was not the case. He was heartily. He was full of heart. He was very natural, spontaneous, and straightforward. There is no etiquette. If one is straightforward with his desire that the self is worth knowing, if he gets to hear such talks, then the kashais become dormant. However, they don't get destroyed completely. They simply become dormant. In this way, someday, he gets a little taste of bliss. That too, it happens when the merit karma of infinite lifetimes come in fruition and he gets a link. Somewhere he would have sown the seeds of attaining liberation, and so he meets someone who can liberate him, or he finds a path where people are heartily. Then he turns back. Read on.
Deepak Bhai, Dada has explained the difference between apratyakhyani and pratyakhyani. When one does not do pratikaman, then that is referred to as apratyakhyani. And when one does pratikaman,
the faults are such that they're so thick that they don't allow a person to do pratikraman. He feels a bit that this is wrong, but the veils come over him again. That's referred to as apratyakhyani. In the past, pratikraman and pratyakhyan have not been done at all. But still, when he comes to this satsang and listens to all of this, then don't some people say, I'm not able to see anything in samayik at all. I'm not able to do pratikraman at all. I don't feel like doing them. On the contrary, I start having aggression. He's like this and he's like that. He's the type with apratyakhyani kashais. He's not able to turn back. He may turn back once or twice out of 100 times. The link breaks from that point. When he remains increasingly absorbed in the atmosphere of satsang, the link breaks very speedily.
Are there any other criteria to recognize whether this is apratyakhyani or pratyakhyani?
For us, call them sticky files. He feels this is wrong, but he ends up quarreling or he even scolds the other person. Some people say, I don't want to scold my child. I don't want to hit him. I want to make him understand. Even then, the very next day, he ends up creating a scene. These are all sticky faults. Even if we do a lot of pratikarman, such faults don't allow one to do pratikarman at all. I understand that whatever I'm doing is wrong. So what about pratikarman? I can barely do one or two pratikarman. Oh, Dada Bhagwan, I ask for forgiveness. Why did you do pratikarman? He'll say, I keep asking for forgiveness so that the other person can improve. It's like that. The veils are such that it doesn't allow him to find his own fault. When he finds his own fault, from then, he moves from apratyakyani to pratyakyani. He has a lot of remorse. Oh no, what have I done? It pinches him constantly. Niruma used to do 800 to 1000 pratikarman for a fault. All the apratyakyani ended and she came into pratyakyani. That too, only in a few matters, they were pratyakyani, whereas in others, they were sanjwalan. That is, the faults arose, but pratikarman was done within 1 second and they shed off. Thereafter, they would never arise again. Those were the types of faults. This is a very beautiful, subtle distinction given by the Vitrag lords.
Apart from this pratikarman, is there any other instrument through which these faults can decrease?
Through this satsang, we have these vidhis, the reading of Dada's speech. All that is very helpful. This satsang is also very helpful. This is because when a person listens to it, he begins to have faith in it. This is indeed the right thing. Moreover, they have attained Gnan. Therefore, it's very speedy. That's why Dada says, they will get liberation within 1, 2, or 3 lifetimes. This is because the faults are dissolving very speedily. Otherwise, for other people, it's very difficult in this Kali Yuga. Guparudev, Srimad Rajchandra, was a living Gnani Purush, but only 4 people were able to attain self-realization from him. The rest felt, this is the right path, but they got dragged into the mole of worldly life. As compared to the population of India, a very small number of people were able to attain it. Dada has given such a spiritual science that when a person sits in the Gnanvidhi, all his veils are destroyed to ashes within no time. Dada says the demerit karma get burnt to ashes. To walk in the direction opposite to the self is itself a demerit karma. To say, I'm Chandubai, is a very big demerit karma. However, this is at the subtlest level. These kinds of veils, these kashais, are referred to as a very big demerit karma. All of these break, anantanubandhi, mithyatva, mishra, and sambhikatva. All kinds of mole break.
How does one move from pratyakyani to sanjwalan? Is it only through pratikaman and due to this atmosphere of satsang? How does it work?
No, didn't Niruma do thousands of pratikaman for a single fault? That kind of state. That doesn't mean we have to count 300, 400. It's not like that. The fault constantly pricks within, like a small particle of sand in the eye. She said the fault didn't leave even after 3 months, or sometimes it didn't leave even after 3 years, yet the fault continued to prick me within. We would take it in samayik every morning and do pratikarman for it. This way the fault keeps on decreasing. Then it moves into sanjwalan. It's mentioned here about pratyakyan kashai. When there's constant pratikarman and pratyakyan, then that is referred to as pratyakyan avran. Constant pratikarman and pratyakyan. It keeps pricking within for 200, 500, or 1,000 times a day. Now that's the station we want to reach in this life at this time while we're in this kshetra, this region. Only then, one more life remains before attaining final liberation. Thereafter, we will certainly go to Mavdik Kshetra. Jai Sachidanand. Thank you.